What was the motivation to go open source with it? It is something because curious for me, because I've been in a few companies and there were always some internal libraries, projects that I liked, but it's not so easy and not every project is a right candidate for going open and be truly used. I'm not talking about adding license file and making the repo public, but I am talking about making it alive and really open.
Yeah, I mean, so I'd been, you could say we had, my team had purview in terms of, you know, build versus buy. We'd been looking at like across the stack and like we were seeing, we created Hamilton back in 2019 and we were seeing very similar-ish things come out and be open source. We're like, hey, I think we have a unique angle of the other tools that we had. Hamilton was, you could say, the easiest to open source. For those who know, Stitch Fix also had, it was very, you know, big on branding. And so if you ever want to know some interesting stories about, you know, techniques and things, you can look up the Stitch Fix multi-threaded blog. So there was a tech branding team, which I was part of, which was, trying to, get quality content out, get quality kind of things out, and that helps the Stitch Fix brand, that helps with hiring. So in terms of motivations, like Stitch Fix, that's the kind of perspective of like, you know, branding. So high quality bar, bring things out that looks good for the brand. And it just happened from, you know, our perspective, you know, and our team that just had Hamilton was kind of the easiest to kind of open source out of the things that we did. And then I think it was, you know, more interesting we built things like, you know, similar to MLflow, configuration driven model pipelines, but I want to say, you know, that's not quite as unique. And so in which case Hamilton also I think is a more unique angle on a particular problem. And so in which case both of those two combined, it was like, yeah, I think this is a good branding opportunity. And then in terms of, yeah, the surface area of the library is also pretty small. You don't need many dependencies, in which case from, you know, making it feasible to maintain from an open source perspective was also kind of relatively low. Since it kind of you just needed Python 3.6. Now it's, you know, 3.6 is sunset, so now it's 3.7 and it just kind of works. So from that perspective, I think it had a pretty good sweet spot of like likely not going to have to be, add too many things to increase adoption, make it usable from the community, but then also the maintenance aspect side of, it was also kind of small. And then a large part was a little bit of unknown, you know, so how much time would we actually be spending, you know, trying to build a community? In which case, you know, I want to say, couldn't always spend more time on that, but it didn't seem to be burdensome. And so that's kind of, you know, the story of how we open sourced it. I did spend a good, you know, couple of months trying to write a blog post though to with it for launch, in which that took a bit of time, but that's always also a good means to kind of, you know, get your thoughts down and get them clearly articulated.
And how did you, how was the launch, like when it comes to adoption from the outside? Can you share with us, how did you promote it? Did it work like from day zero, or it took some time to make it more popular?
Yeah, so thankfully Stitch Fix had a blog that had, you know, at least a reasonable amount of readership. Paired that with the blog, in which case, you know, got a couple of hundred stars in a couple of months. Otherwise, you know, tried to, you know, we have a Slack community that you can join, you could say, have a comparison to say, you know, how well, you know, it was compared to something else, but, you know, people are adopting it outside of Stitch Fix. So UK Government Digital Services is using Hamilton for a national feedback pipeline. There is, you know, a guy internally using it at IBM for a small kind of internal search tool kind of product. There's the problem with open source is actually you don't know who's actually using you in production, since, you know, telemetry and other things are kind of difficult, right? But otherwise, people came in, created issues, asked questions, and so in which case that gave us more energy to, you know, be in there and help, right? So
what about first pull request, useful pull request from external?
we were fortunate to have a guy called James Lamb come in. He's been on a few open source projects, and he's like, try to help us with the kind of the repository documentation and kind of structure. So like cleaning up and making it easy for someone, an outside contributor, to come in and like say run our tests and things like that. So like, I want to say kind of grunt worky, but super, super valuable in the long run, since he is like gave feedback like, hey, this pull request template is just way too long. How can we shorten it? Like, you're going to scare off contributors to like, you know, in some which case he gave us, a few good pointers, helped set up the structure a little bit. So more than one pull request, but essentially, kind of repo hygiene that enables other people to kind of contribute more easily.
I think it's very important. I remember, maybe you remember a project called OpenStack. It was before Kubernetes was so got so popular. Basically, private cloud type of software. There was a component that was doing telemetry. I don't remember the name of the component, but I remember I really wanted to contribute and fix one annoying thing I was experiencing. But after 4 or 5 days setting it up, like I was not even able to run unit tests, I gave up. So it really resonates with me that, like, making it easy to for contributor to at least test it, right?